This is full-time Catholic radio for Southeast Michigan, 990 WDEO, Ypsilanti, Detroit, or on the internet at WDEO.net.
Hey, good afternoon. I'm Al Kresta. Glad to be with you for another hour here talking about the things that matter most. We'll be talking about the rollout of the COVID-19 vaccine. Pfizer has its trucks carrying the vaccine, chugging across the country this morning. Healthcare workers receive doses. We're expecting this, of course, to continue over the next few weeks. Most of the vaccines have been found to be morally acceptable, at least the ones on the front lines right now. We'll tell you about those that are not that have some moral problems with them. And we'll also take the, again, there's a public health question. What is the role of the government in asking its citizens to submit to receiving a vaccine? Dr. Steve Doran will be joining us, and that's coming up in this first segment of Crest in the Afternoon. Also, we're going to be taking time with Father Christian Kappes and William Albrecht, who have put together an outstanding brief but sharp, even definitive guide for solving biblical questions about the Blessed Virgin Mary. This, of course, Christmas time, Advent, Nativity, the Feast of the Mother of God on January 1st. We've got Our Lady of Guadalupe, and Immaculate Conception. These are all December, January festivals. So you can argue that May might be the month of Mary, but certainly December through the Feast. Well, I've taken through Epiphany. You can also make the case this is the month of Mary. And we're going to take a look at the biblical material. That's going to be our focus, is primarily the biblical material, using the scriptures to demonstrate the Catholic Church's perpetual teaching about the Mother of God. But first, let's get to today's headlines.
Thanks, Al. Good afternoon, everyone. This is your Ave Maria Radio News for Monday, December 14th. It's the Feast of St. John of the Cross. Today's news is brought to you by Visiting Angels, providing loving care and assistance for seniors in need. More information can be found at visitingangels.com. Health and Human Services Secretary Alex Azar is stressing the need for Americans to get a coronavirus vaccine when they can.
At 95% efficacy, this vaccine is extraordinarily effective at protecting you from the virus. Getting vaccinated will help keep you, your family, and your country healthy and safe.
He said it's like getting any other vaccine. However, Azar admitted there's more work that needs to be done around education about the vaccine. Azar said he goes for the vaccine's safety and efficacy. Meanwhile, the U.S. Surgeon General is addressing the coronavirus rollout when it comes to minority communities.
We know that lack of trust is a major cause for reluctance, especially in communities of color.
Dr. Jerome Adams insisting that Americans must follow public health measures even as vaccinations begin. Joe Biden is formally racking up electoral college wins in key battleground states. Electors have certified Biden's victories in Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, Georgia, Nevada, and Arizona. Electoral college votes are being tabulated in states across the U.S. today. Meanwhile, the Wisconsin Supreme Court is ruling against President Trump in his effort to overturn the state's results. The state's highest courts affirmed Biden's win by a 4-3 margin. A search is continuing in Nigeria after an attack on a school. We get more from correspondent Bill Zimfer.
It all started Friday when attackers on motorcycles stormed an all-boys school in the town of Kankara, taking some of the children. Hundreds of the students fled into a nearby forest to escape, but thus far, several hundred have yet to be accounted for. The country's defense minister has vowed to rescue any students abducted and punish the attackers.
And I'm Steve Clark, Ave Maria, Radio News.
Hey, good afternoon. I'm Al Kresta. Well, there's a lot of news, of course, on the coronavirus vaccine front. We've got the vaccines that are, so in some cases, being shipped already and being distributed. We also have a statement from the U.S. bishops that came out early, or at least has been reported earlier today, And the U.S. Bishops' Conference has said that Catholics can take two of the three available COVID-19 vaccines, even though they were developed with a remote connection to morally compromised cell lines. This I'm reading here from the CNA, the Catholic News Agency, copy on this. In a statement released Monday, the bishops also said it is morally permissible in some circumstances to receive a third vaccine developed in close connection with aborted cell lines, but that Catholics cannot allow the pandemic to desensitize or weaken our determination to oppose the evil of abortion. We'll come back to that a little bit later. With me right now, though, to really take a look at this vaccine and our relationship to it is Dr. Stephen Doran, practicing neurosurgeon in Omaha. He's a member of the State of Nebraska COVID-19 Task Force. He's also in formation for the permanent diaconate and is the bioethicist for the Archdiocese of Omaha. He's co-founder with his wife, Sharon, of Seeking the Truth, or Seeking Truth Catholic Bible Study. Steve, good to have you back. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Good to be back.
Well, let's go to the fact that just the speed with which these vaccines were developed. This has probably raised the bar, do you think, for future bringing of these type medical advances to the public?
Well, maybe yes, maybe no. I think one of the differences here, why it's come to public use so quickly, is that enough money was funded for these companies to create vaccine even before it was approved. So there's this possibility of a huge number of vaccines that just never got distributed. I don't know that that would happen again unless we were in a similar situation of such timeliness and urgency like a pandemic.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you don't think then among consumers or among healthcare professionals or even among the manufacturers themselves, that this sets any kind of precedent for future development?
Well, I mean, I don't think so, but you have to realize that the FDA does have this emergency use authorization just as a matter of policy. Then
okay.
That's how these vaccines were distributed. So
okay.
Certainly it could happen, but there's already that policy in place.
That's
so
been there. All right.
This isn't necessarily a present.
Gotcha. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the vaccines that are going to be immediately available. We've got the Pfizer COVID vaccine chugging across the country now, being distributed in some places. Of the three that are out there, what can you tell us about them from the standpoint of their moral legitimacy and also of their effectiveness?
Well, so the effectiveness is probably the easier question to answer. Both the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines have been shown to be greater than 90% effective in preventing symptomatic COVID disease. Now, the effectiveness for preventing asymptomatic transmission has not been measured. The vaccine produced by AstraZeneca and Oxford shows a lower efficacy of about 70%, but interestingly, when they inadvertently gave a lower dose for some people, their first dose being lower than what they planned to give, those patients actually ended up with a 90% efficacy, too. So anyway, you know, certainly the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines show efficacy far exceeding what the threshold was for release. The threshold was only 50% efficacy.
Wow.
So that's kind of the easy question.
Wow.
To answer.
Okay. What about the morality involved? What usually just comes up in relationship to whether aborted fetal cell lines were used?
Right, and this is where I think we have to make a distinction between the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines versus the Oxford and AstraZeneca. None of the three vaccines is totally clear of relationships with abortion, but the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines have a much more remote connection with abortion than does the one from AstraZeneca and Oxford.
Mm-hmm. Exactly what does that mean, remote, as proximate versus remote in these settings?
Well, so the question at hand is the fact that these manufacturers are using a cell line called the HEK cell line that was first developed, in the 70s, I think it was, using embryonic cells from an aborted fetus. And so all of them use this cell line in one way or another. Now, the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines have used it just for testing purposes. They don't use this cell line for actual manufacturing of the vaccine itself, whereas the Oxford and AstraZeneca use the HEK or HEK cells for actual production of the vaccine. So it does, and it's actually specific to HEK-293. So that's the problem, is that the Pfizer vaccine not only uses it for testing, but also uses it for development. So the connection is much closer to this cell line that was created a number of decades ago. But we have to acknowledge, and the bishops acknowledge this, that under certain circumstances, a Catholic in good conscience can receive any of those three vaccines, even the one produced by Oxford and AstraZeneca, depending upon the circumstances.
Is there any kind of, one can receive the vaccine, does one have any obligation to object or to protest in some way?
Yeah, they do, Al. That's a good point. In fact, a lot of this comes from magisterial teaching, the Dignitas Persona document that was put out by the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith in 2008 under Pope Benedict, and it specifically talks about the fact that these vaccines can be used, but keeping in mind, and I'll quote here, that everyone has the duty to make known their disagreement and to ask that the healthcare system make other types of vaccines available. So it doesn't get us off the hook. You know, even if we don't have a choice,
mm-hmm.
and even if for grave reasons we choose to use one of these vaccines, we still have an obligation to voice our concern. And the bishops have done this. The bishops from the very beginning were strongly encouraging manufacturers and the government to create vaccines using cell lines that had nothing to do at all with abortion.
Okay. Will there be mandatory reception? Do you think the government is going to require people receive the vaccine?
Well, from a federal standpoint, my understanding is constitutionally they probably couldn't have, even if they wanted to, and there certainly has been no indication at the federal level of having desire to do so.
Okay.
At the state level, though, that's different. States do have that possibility of mandating vaccines, and there is precedence for that. You know, for example, in 2019, the New York City required people who are living in certain zip codes to get the measles vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's even some legislature out there in New York, a bill that was just proposed on December 4th, requiring individuals who were otherwise healthy enough to take the vaccine. Now, that particular bill has not been advanced or approved, but states do have that right. And this is probably the only example I could find where a state has actually gone so far as to introduce a bill for mandating it. Now, it seems unlikely that's going to happen, I think, on a number of reasons. I think there would be just a huge uproar for many reasons.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about a vaccine that was being distributed under an emergency use authorization. That means the vaccine is not the same as a vaccine that's been around for years or decades, and so there are legitimate concerns about safety.
Okay.
While certainly the studies appear to show that the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines appear to have few side effects and they tend to be minor, we don't have long-term data. And so to mandate its use at any level of government seems highly unlikely, but it's out there. The New York State legislature has a bill out there. Now, it's possible you could end up having an employer mandate the vaccine, but even at least here locally in Omaha, there's no intention of doing that here in the healthcare systems of mandating anything. But again, that precedence is certainly out there, and it could theoretically happen.
I'd like to speak to this question of fear of unintended side effects. People by temperament, some people are more accepting. Other people are more standoffish. They don't know. They weigh things differently. They have different prudential standards. I don't doubt that there are people listening to us right now that say to themselves, good heavens, this is all new, just like you said, all new. What about if there's a problem, they find out a problem, 3, 4, 5, 10 years down the road, that this impacts, sterility or, fertility in some way? What about when people have those fears, how do they deal with them pastorally?
I think we...
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we first of all have to acknowledge them as being understandable, and that I will tell you that even amongst healthcare providers, there's not necessarily unanimity in receiving the vaccine. For example, they did an internal poll at one of the major hospitals here in Omaha, and 90% of the physicians said they would take it, but only 60% of the nurses. So even people within the healthcare profession aren't unanimous in their desire to receive it. So first of all, I think it's an understandable and rational concern, but then you have to balance that off with what you're trying to prevent. You're
right.
Trying to prevent yourself not only yourself getting sick, but you're also, quite honestly, there's this duty to the common good, preventing those who are vulnerable who maybe can't take the vaccine because of health reasons or don't have access to the vaccine yet because they're not in the first wave coming out. So all those things have to be balanced out. I personally would never criticize somebody for not taking it, because I think those concerns need to be heard. It's different than other vaccines that have been out there for a long time, and I'll say it again, this is released with an emergency use authorization. That, I mean, those words alone tell you something.
When it comes to we talked about the morality of this. We've got about 40 seconds here. Is there anything that you can suggest to us about the effectiveness of these, that one is better than the other, the Moderna versus the Pfizer, for instance?
The Moderna and Pfizer, there's nominal difference between the two,
okay. Which
was how you should expect. They're both very similar. You know, you're talking a few percentage points that probably will not end up being statistically significant. So
okay.
I think they're both pretty, very effective.
Very good. Steve, thanks so much. Great talking with you again.
Thank you, Al.
Dr. Stephen Doran, again, has been involved in this. He's also trained in bioethics, National Catholic Bioethics Center. Practicing neurosurgeon, working for the state of Nebraska in this whole area of COVID-19. Great to have him with us.
This program is brought to you by the following nonprofit underwriter.
You don't let an oil company decide which car you drive, and you don't let an airline decide your destination. So why let insurance limit your health care options? We believe there's a better way of doing health care. CMF Curo is the Catholic health care ministry that gives you control over your health care decisions by partnering with one of the nation's most trusted health-sharing organizations. Now is the time to experience affordable, pro-life health care. Find out more at MyCatholicHealthCare.com. That's MyCatholicHealthCare.com.
People ask how they can care for older family members who can't fully care for themselves. One answer is Visiting Angels, America's choice in senior home care. Visiting Angels assists adults nationwide with 600 locations to continue living at home and not have to move into a nursing home. Their caregivers provide assistance in hygiene, meals, and light housework. Services are provided up to 24 hours per day, and you can select your caregiver before service begins. More information, including franchise opportunities, is on the web at visitingangels.com.
The Catholic Church teaches that Jesus Christ is literally and wholly present, body and blood, soul and divinity, under the appearances of bread and wine. St. John the Apostle records the John chapter 6 Bread of Life discourse, in which Jesus states that his flesh is true food and his blood true drink. Who better to understand John's writings and subsequent teachings than a disciple and student of John, St. Ignatius of Antioch? In his letter to the Smyrnians in 110 A.D., Ignatius writes, "I have no taste for corruptible food, nor for the pleasures of this life. I desire the bread of God, which is the flesh of Jesus Christ. And for drink, I desire his blood, which is love incorruptible." The Catholic Church absolutely follows St. John and St. Ignatius in taking Jesus at his word. Examining the truths of the Catholic faith, this is faithforensics.org.
Every morning I get a prayer email from the high school I attended. As a communications evangelist, I'm always looking for those quotes, sayings, and words of wisdom as it relates to how we communicate as Christians. This one caught my attention. "When I listen and speak, dear Lord, may I be steady and strong in goodness. As the scripture says, be quick to hear, but deliberate in answering. If you know what to say, answer your neighbor. Do not be called double-tongued and do not lay traps with your tongue. First, Lord, help me listen carefully. Then when I speak, may I be clear and honest. But when I have nothing to contribute, help me have the humility to hold my tongue. Come, aid us with the gifts of listening and speaking. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I've always struggled with holding my tongue and listening more. We all have things we need to work on. This is one of mine. This has been a Christ Center communication message. I'm Vanessa Denhagarmo, a communications evangelist.
Do you remember writing your Christmas wish list as a child and wondering what Santa would bring? Well, in many developing countries like Haiti, most children don't make Christmas lists and they don't expect Christmas gifts. Often every penny their parents earn must go to basic needs like food, shelter, and water. Now picture the joy of surprising a child with their first Christmas gift. You can spark that magical moment by sending them a box of joy at boxofjoy.org. A rosary and the story of Jesus is included in every box of joy. Give today at boxofjoy.org.
Be a blessing to your neighbors in need through your gift to Catholic Charities of Southeast Michigan. Together we can change the faces of despair, loneliness, hunger, and addiction, one blessing at a time. As the charitable arm for the corporal works of mercy throughout the Archdiocese of Detroit, Catholic Charities exists to provide the services that make a difference in the lives of over 20,000 people each and every year in Southeast Michigan. So how would you like to bless your neighbor today? Visit ccsem.org/donate to choose your involvement.
Hey, good afternoon. I'm Al Kresta. Commonly, for men and women who come into full, non-Catholic Christians who end up coming into full communion with the Catholic Church, a sizable number, a percentage of them, will tell you that some of their biggest theological worries and doctrinal worries came up surrounding the Blessed Mother. They had respect for Mary as the one who received the visitation of the angel and the commission to be the mother of our Savior. But when it comes to the Church's dogmas regarding Immaculate Conception, the bodily assumption, the perpetual virginity, they say, gosh, I just don't think you can find that in Scripture. And they don't, that's often a way of hanging back. Before they can affirm, you know, before they can state that they affirm all that the Catholic Church teaches. I know this because it was my case back in the mid-1980s. It was a few years yet before I finally realized that the Church's teaching on the Blessed Mother was, first of all, about the nature of Jesus. It had a lot to do with the whole mystery of the Incarnation. But we have two guests with us right now who have put a lot of thought into this and have provided a definitive guide for solving biblical questions about Mary. It's called Mary Among the Evangelists, and the authors are Reverend Dr. Christian Kappes, currently academic dean and professor at St. Cyril and Methodius Byzantine Catholic Seminary in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. He's the author of numerous books and articles in peer-reviewed publications that touch upon Mariology. And we also have with us William Albrecht, who is a co-author of the book and is co-host for Reason and Theology. He appears on EWTN, Virgin Most Powerful Radio, and other networks. He runs a website dedicated to the early church fathers that includes unique translations, articles, commentaries, and debates on the fathers in the church. Gentlemen, good to have you with me. Thank you.
Thanks for having us. Yeah, thank you very much. What a pleasure to be here with you, Al.
Well, let me ask, Father, when did what was the origin of the book? When did it first become clear that this was something that had to make its way into print?
Well, it's an excellent starting point because the book is really a development from a series of popular articles that were provided for free on the very website that you advertised on William's behalf, in which we just wanted to provide Christians, and specifically a lot of Catholic Christians, since that's a lot of the people that William dialogues with, but he also has informal but regular meetings with Orthodox, Oriental Orthodox, and even Protestant Christians. And I proffered or offered him to do a little article on the Annunciation, and from there I was really astounded at how many downloads William was reporting that there were. And so we put together a little program to do about, I guess altogether it was about four or five articles that I tried to keep under 15 pages apiece in order to try to help them understand what I was seeing from reading the Greek New Testament in dialogue with the Greek Old Testament, by and large. And the articles really took off, and at a certain point, William and I agreed that probably the next step is to compile these and perfect the articles, which were in a popular, non-published fashion, and to provide those in a book that people could purchase, even though the information, about 60 or 70% of it, was already available online.
William, what were some of the most vexing questions that made you realize you had to settle down and get this material in print and available? What were some of the most vexing questions regarding the Blessed Mother?
That is a fantastic question, Al. And working and dealing in apologetics for quite some time, I realized that coming over into Catholicism from Protestantism, the frequent objections you commonly hear, as you know quite well, are, well, how can Mary be immaculate because she needed a Savior?
Right.
How could Mary have been given honor by our Lord and Savior if in Luke 11 she was, you know, clearly, you know, there was clearly a rebuke there, a direction to not giving our mother honor, and many other questions that really, I mean, I'll be quite honest, Al, they were on my mind when I was a Protestant, and I recognized coming over into Catholicism, our separated brothers and sisters still had those on their minds. And really, even though I've been in the church, thanks be to God, for so many years, these objections have not gone away on the other side.
Right, right. Now, even though there are much better apologetic materials today than there were 30 years ago, those objections
yes.
are still out there. Yeah. I agree.
Yes.
Well, let's get to the one other methodology issue here, and that is your focus upon the scriptures themselves. You make a point of really saying that you wanted to root this argument in the biblical texts. Oftentimes, people will say, "Well, you know, yeah, the scriptures we believe in the inspiration of scripture, but you know, we don't get all of our doctrine from scripture, so it's not very important to really make the effort to tie these dogmas to scripture." How do you reply to that?
Would you like to go?
That
first?
Is a really good question. Yeah, go ahead, Father. I'd rather Father take that one. That's a great question for Father.
Sure, go ahead, Father.
Yeah. I think that the church has allowed a wide berth for that. There's a classical sort of division between a Franciscan and a Dominican approach. One thinking that the scriptures do contain materially everything that we believe in our very, very expansive creed and magisterium. And another one saying that it's sufficient that we can reason from the scriptures necessarily to some of these truths.
Right.
And we didn't really weigh in on that. We just took as the point of departure the presumption that we could find everything Marian-wise, to say nothing of the other dogmas of the church, in the scriptures. And we wanted to figure out what we could find out by just taking a look at the use, again, mainly of the Greek Old Testament by the New Testament writers, who 90% of the time are cataloged to quote from the Greek Old Testament.
That's
and
right.
Because it is not a fashionable thing to do, even among scholars, we made a lot of fun, interesting, and I think ultimately irrefutable discoveries that really privilege Our Lady.
So it's very important then to focus in on that Greek translation of the Old Testament. Is that right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, Luke especially, who, of course, has the most to say about Mary, is, by and large, just weaving various citations from the Septuagint. As you can imagine, if, as I've said in another time and place, you know, when you walked into an ancient Bible store, you didn't have 1,001 translations. You only had one.
That's right. Yeah.
That's all you had, and basically you had some variations with that one that was available in the popular language of Greek. We don't really have Latin translations of the Bible that we can verify until about 250 AD.
Right.
And so basically you're kind of stuck with one edition, which makes it really easy for everybody to know where your stuff is coming from. But eventually the church got to the point where when you had new editions and different editions coming out, that people kind of forgot
to prioritize reading, I think, the only edition that was available, the writing of the New Testament.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What is the relationship between the Greek translation of the Old Testament, Septuagint, and any of the early Hebrew translations, or Hebrew presentations, excuse me?
Yeah, and I'll let William add a couple cents on this one, but just in summary, I'd say I certainly think that 80 or 90 to 10 split is important because it means that you can't use one without the other.
Okay.
And there are competing traditions, meaning we're not really sure in any one given time or place which one we should prefer based off of scholarship.
Mm-hmm.
Our key of presuming which is the right reading is the one that the New Testament writers use, of course, because they're canonical scripture.
Right.
And then I would say that probably the last thing maybe to keep in mind with the relationship between the Septuagint and the Hebrew or the Masoretic text is because you have a lot of Jewish people who are translating into Greek and they're perfectly fine with taking their baseball and football idioms and just translating them literally into Greek,
mm-hmm.
They don't make any sense to a Greek speaker. You have to be a Hebrew who's speaking in Greek with a lot of these idioms. So you can't really read the Septuagint unless you know a lot of the Hebrew idiom that's behind what they're trying to say in the Greek language.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, if you want to add anything to that?
That is a great point, and I totally agree with Father. And I think another thing that we realized when working on this this project, Al, is when we look at the evangelist, we look at Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we recognize how heavily reliant they are on the Greek text, the Septuagint. But to me, what is even more incredible, such as when we touch upon the perpetual virginity of Mary, which, by the way, we believe that you can clearly see that Mary's taken a vow of virginity there, we recognize, what is Luke, who clearly wrote in the style of a historian, what is Luke referring to? And we recognize that all of everything in Luke, as you know, Al, is so heavily reliant on the Greek, even the virgin birth prophecy.
Right.
He would have clearly known that his audience would have been familiar with what he was hearkening to.
They would have picked up all the implications of some of these key words that he used. I agree. Well, let's talk a little bit about that, because this is related to the brothers and sisters of Jesus. That's where you're being in chapter 1, too. Mary in the Gospel of Matthew and Mark, the question you raise at the very beginning, who are the brothers and sisters of Jesus? The significance of that is that if he had biological brothers and sisters or those who passed through the womb of Mary, that would be the death of the Catholic doctrine of the perpetual virginity of Mary. So let's go to that. What is the problem behind the phrase, the brothers and sisters of the Lord?
That is a great question. Yeah, Father, you want to maybe start off with that, and I'll piggyback off of what you had there?
No, as you wish. Yeah, I think one of the fun first things to think about that is often missed, and I'm very humbled that Scott Hahn was one who drew our attention to this, was that it's an original talking point nowadays. I don't think it would have been an original talking point to people that were, again, reading the only edition of the Bible that exists, which was Greek and Greek, for the average Christian.
I just heard the music come up. Let's take a break. We'll come back and pick up the conversation from there. We'll have sufficient time to unpack it. We're talking with Father Christian Kappes and William Albrecht. They are together the authors of Mary Among the Evangelists. It's the definitive guide for solving biblical questions about Mary.
Solidarity HealthShare began out of the Christian tradition of neighbor helping neighbor. They're a non-profit medical cost-sharing ministry in which their members share in each other's eligible medical expenses. Solidarity HealthShare is not insurance, but rather an alternative way to pay for medical costs that adheres to the teachings of the Catholic Church. They'll never share in a medical care that goes against their values and morals, such as abortion, contraception, and sterilization. More information available at solidarityhealthshare.org or at 844-313-4999.
Proud Life for Cross America, the Billboard people. Did you know you were kicking in your mommy's tummy before you were born?
We were?
Yep. I just learned at school that babies move and kick before they're even born.
No wonder we're so good at soccer.
Hello, I'm Marian Kuharski, the director of Pro-Life Across America. We know that conversations about right to life have become very heated, even angry. We stay away from that political fray. We're non-political and totally educational. We don't scream or scold. Instead, we help people working through unplanned pregnancies know their options. We're here to help both mom and the baby, and we rely on people like you to help with our mission. Please call 1-800-366-7773. Check us out on Facebook, YouTube, or at ProLifeAcrossAmerica.org.
A baby's heart is beating 18 days from conception.
Peace does not begin with presidents and prime ministers. It begins with you and me. What is peace? Where do I find peace? How can I be peace in this troubled world? Hi, this is Peggy Stanton. Please join me on A Place of Peace as we seek the answers to these timely and timeless questions.
A Place of Peace, Saturdays at 11 a.m. and Sundays at 9:30 a.m. on Ave Maria Radio.
This week on Christ is the Answer, Father John Ricardo is speaking on motherhood and the biblical vision of marriage. It's so important to understand God's will for us in our relationships, especially our relationship with our spouse and our children. There is a beautiful design in Scripture of what the family is, the covenant bond that gives it structure, and the source of love that gives it strength to endure. Tune in for Christ is the Answer, Monday through Fridays at 11 a.m. on Ave Maria Radio.
How beautiful and exciting is it to drive around during this Christmas season and notice the Christmas decorations and lights on homes and businesses? This truly is the most wonderful time of the year, and for that reason, we're celebrating our Big Finish 2020, going on all month. Right now, all new vehicles are eligible for Employee Plus pricing, which in most cases is the $7,000 to $10,000 advantage. Pinckney Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram wishes you and your family a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Experience the difference during our Big Finish 2020. Shop online at PinckneyChrysler.com.
Do you own popular index mutual funds or ETFs? If so, you're automatically owned shares of companies that conflict with your moral beliefs. Ave Maria Mutual Funds are managed to conform to pro-life and pro-family values. Long-term investors can invest in the no-load Ave Maria Mutual Funds. The experienced professional portfolio managers make decisions based on investment fundamentals and pro-life values. You can learn more about Ave Maria Mutual Funds today at 866-AVE-MARIA or visit AveMariaFunds.com.
This Ave Maria program is brought to you by the following nonprofit underwriter.
Catholic Charities enabled 500,000 people last year to reach financial self-sufficiency. Consider a donor-advised fund with Catholic Charities. Streamline your charitable giving while supporting the causes you care about. Consider a donor-advised fund with Catholic Charities. Learn more about how you can maximize your charitable donations with a simple, flexible, and efficient giving tool. Visit ccusa.gives. That's ccusa.gives.
Good afternoon, I'm Al Kresta. We're looking at Mary Among the Evangelists. That's the title of the book by Father Christian Kappes and William Albrecht, the definitive guide for solving biblical questions about Mary. And that's what we were doing. We were getting the kind of the method of doing this in the first segment. Now we're going to one of the questions that non-Catholics often bring up, and that is the question of the brothers and sisters of Jesus. If Mary was, in fact, perpetually virgin, if there were no other biological brothers and sisters of Jesus, that is, brothers and sisters who had passed through the womb of Mary, then what do we do with these phrases, the brothers and sisters of Jesus? Don't these phrases, are they incompatible with the Catholic Church's teaching here? And you begin your book with Mark chapter 6, which deals with this phrase, the brothers of and sisters of Jesus. So, Father, go ahead and pick us up where we were just before the break.
Sure. I think the great thing about the book is, though we spend a lot of time prefacing languages, the book is designed that you can just meditatively read through it without any need to reference to foreign languages. But and in fact, one of the most clear arguments is this first point, which is in Matthew 1, you know, we're all going to have this read for our Christmas Gospels, the lineage of Jesus, And the first thing that sticks out, as was considered fascinating by some of the people that, read the book, which I think is really interesting myself, that they were so fascinated with this, was the very first gospel and the very first lines already tells us who brothers and sisters can be. And that is when Matthew tells us that Abraham begot Isaac and Isaac begot Jacob, and then Jacob begot Joseph and all of his brothers. But his brothers, his brethren, as they're used in the New Testament, are mostly brothers of another mother. There's only really, really Benjamin is of the same mother, right?
That's good, right. Right.
So, you know, pretty much 90% of the time when you're talking about the brothers of Joseph, you're talking about sons of a different mother, of a different womb, to use your inferences there. So we already see that Matthew provides for us the principal key for, looking at everything that is going to be upcoming in the rest of the Gospels, that it means the child of a different mother. I think one of the other more fascinating passages, before I know William's probably chomping at the bit to talk about Mary's vow of perpetual virginity, especially because there's all kinds of fun patristic stuff that we've found in addition to what's already out. The other great verse is, if we were to go to Mark 6, which is early on in the book, we would see that Jesus goes back to his hometown, Nazareth, and some of his opposition party, people that really are trying to put up a block against the gospel being preached in his hometown, Nazareth, they list off very precisely the people they think that are in Jesus' family that aren't worthy of mention. They're not honorable people, or they're actually actively opposing his ministry. So the first two that they mention without honor are Mary, and then in the list comes a woman who has Simon and Joses and James. We may be familiar with these being called the brothers of Jesus, just like in Matthew's gospel. They could be sons of a different mother, but we don't know that yet. So Jesus' enemies list is quite precise. It's first his mother, then this woman who has four sons, of whom I've named Joses, etc., Simon, and those are called his brothers. And then there's these native girls that live in Nazareth that are called his sisters, and they are actively opposing him in Nazareth. And it looks at first that we don't really know much more until we go down just a few more verses in Mark 6 from that description, and we see Jesus answers with great precision, tit for tat, the entire list that is proposed to him by his enemies. And he skips over his mother, who is with honor, and this is going to happen in Matthew's gospel again, and it's even more precise in Matthew's gospel. The reason why he skips over his mother is because Matthew is going to add the story of Joseph's annunciation and Mary's virgin birth. And this is quite clear that in Matthew's gospel, the same thing happens, where Joseph in the enemies list, who is mentioned, and Mary in the enemies list, which is mentioned in Matthew, is ignored because they are people with honor. So Jesus skips over naming Mary as a person that is without honor. He admits that the second group listed by his enemies are family members that aren't special. They're not kings, they're not prophets, they're not rich people, and yet he calls them not his brothers, but he answers his enemies list and he says, a prophet is without honor among his cousins. And the word that he uses is syngenes, or syngenes.
Which is different than adelphos, right?
What's that?
That's different than adelphos or adelphoi.
Yeah, exactly. It's this word, if you look it up in your best dictionary or lexicon of Greek, it's quite clear that syngenes, or cousin, is meant to be diametrically opposed to child of the same mother. So the entire definition of what Jesus is saying in his tit-for-tat list to his enemies is that these four people that you just mentioned, those are my syngenes, those are my cousins. That means, by definition in Greek, they are the children of a different mother. And then the last group that he answers in the tit-for-tat list, the active opposition that he's getting in Nazareth in Mark 6, he lists those persons as members of his household. And what we notice is that St. Jerome, I think William for this discovery, is St. Jerome had already noticed that in all the synoptic gospels is there's a threefold division of a house. There's the heads of the family, which are the military age young men. Then there is a household, which is what these girls belong to, and the definition of a household in the book of Numbers in the Old Testament, which the synoptics are using verbatim, is the extended family, not brothers and sisters, the extended family.
Yeah.
And so what we end up having then is Jesus in Matthew's gospel, as well as in Mark's gospel, use that exact list of his enemies to mean his cousins, his children that live in the same general vicinity but are of a different mother, and the people in his household which are extended members of his family, namely his female cousins. And so we exactly know there that we must exclude all these lists of the so-called brothers and sisters from being of the same mother. But that's a little bit different from saying perpetual virginity, so I'll let
right.
William take up the slack.
So that's one way of dealing with the distinctions between cousins, household, relatives, biological brothers, sisters. What about your argument, William, that Mary was perpetually virgin because, in fact, she made a vow? So tell us what the biblical material offers us in that argument.
That is a fantastic question there, Al. And I think when we look at Luke, we recognize clearly that when Luke is breaking down the text, that he's referring to the book of Judges 11. And again, the one thing we clearly like to point out is in the book we rely heavily on the scripture, but we can recognize that even the early church fathers recognized this connection. Because if we go to Judges 11, we notice that in the beginning, Jephthah makes a vow to God before a battle. The Spirit of the Lord gives the inspiration to Jephthah to make the vow. It sounds really familiar, doesn't it? The Spirit of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
If he wins the battle, the first thing he encounters in the way home, he will offer it up to the Lord as a sacrifice.
That's right.
So the points in Holy Writ are really clear. Jephthah, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, made a vow. And when he encounters his daughter, and she's notified of the unfortunate circumstance, she responds by saying, "And she said to her father, 'Let this be done for me. Let me alone for 2 months.'" And remember, Mary visited Elizabeth for how long? For 3 months.
Yeah.
And this is incredible. Look at this, Al. She comes back, Jephthah's daughter, on the third month, as the Greek text tells us, as she is left alone for two, she goes away to mourn and bewail her virginity.
Right.
She finds out she has been vowed to perpetual virginity. And Luke, the incredible historian that he is, Al, catches this perfectly. And in Luke 1, Mary is saying the exact words, "How can this be?" when the angel Gabriel greets her, "Since I do not know man." The fathers view these words as a vow, and the text does as well, because it's clearly there in Judges. And another thing, Al, that's been so important that we've relied on to show this clearly in the text, and Father noted this. Father looked clearly in the biggest, the massive collection of Greek texts known to mankind, the Thesaurus Lingua Graecae, in all of Greek literature prior to 100 AD, there are only two areas with this citation. That is Judges 11 and Luke 1. Luke is directly quoting that and telling us she knew not man. She remained
just like Jephthah's daughter. Yeah, just like Jephthah's daughter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Wow. Very good. Very good. What else can you extract more from that encounter between Gabriel and Mary regarding her future? There's the reference there to Jephthah's daughter. What about the language that's used by Luke about the Holy Spirit overshadowing her?
Yes.
Do you want to take that up, William, or did you want me to?
Yeah, I'll take that up really quickly, and then I'll let you follow up with it. That's a great question, Al. And in fact, we cover that clearly. We show that clearly the language being utilized here shows, without a shadow of a doubt, that Mary is being shown as the new ark of the covenant. The language is very clear here. And the language, by the way, as you know, Al, we find all these parallelisms of Mary being the new ark, what happens, the baby leaps in the womb, all of the language. Mary is carrying the word, you know, the new word.
Right.
Mary is this special figure that is carrying our incarnate Lord and Savior. So really everything that is broken down there points to her being the new ark of the new covenant. We show that as well, but incredible, Al, how this text is so loaded with theology, because not only does it point to that, but it shows that Mary was the one, the very first one, to hear that word and to vouchsafe that word. And indeed, there is no objection in Luke 11 that people think there is, because when Luke says, blessed, rather, are those that hear the word of God and obey it, we're directly told in Luke 1 that she is the one that heard
right.
that word first
right.
and made it.
Yes, so even in the place where some people see that Jesus is minimizing Mary's status, he's in fact calling them back to what she did at the moment of the Annunciation. She was the one who heard God's word and kept it. Very good.
Absolutely, yes.
We've got about 90 seconds left here, and let me just ask a more general question, because I think this is a wonderful guide for people to take seriously the biblical text when it comes to these dogmas regarding the Blessed Mother. What was your favorite, I'm just curious, what was your favorite biblical insight as you worked through this, William?
My favorite one was definitely Luke 2. I would recommend people check it out for Luke 2. We clearly show that the purification there, which we're told in the Greek was for Mary and Christ, is not one for sin, but rather highlights the special role of Mary in salvation history. And I know Father has his special one as well, so I want to give him the last word.
Father, we've got about 15 seconds. Go ahead.
All right. Well, it's definitely the relationship between Judges 11, Mary's perpetual vow of virginity, which justifies Ambrose, Gregory Nyssa, and Augustine. And we even have, through William, the money quotes for that one now.
Very good. Gentlemen, thank you so much. We'll talk again. It's a marvelous book. And it's. I love the, I also like the length of it. It's only 150 pages, and it's packed with material. Thank you.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you.
Kresta in the Afternoon is underwritten by the following nonprofit organization, Real Estate for Life. Buying or selling your home or business property? Real Estate for Life can connect you to one of 900 pro-life real estate agents around the world. When Real Estate for Life receives a referral fee, they donate 80% of the referral check to Ave Maria Radio and Students for Life. More information at realestateforlife.org or 877-LIFE-US1. That's realestateforlife.org.
I'm Dr. Stan Williams, and this is Evidences for Christianity. Some critics of the New Testament suggest it is filled with the prejudicial opinions of the writers, and not exactly what Christ taught, and therefore not reliable. They claim the stories and teachings were altered to bolster the church's authority. But the most prolific writer of the New Testament distinguished Christ's teachings from his own. Paul's discussion of marriage and celibacy in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 is a perfectly good place for him to pass off his own opinions as those of Christ. But he does just the opposite. Twice, in verses 10 and 12, he writes plainly, "This say I, not the Lord." And that's evidence for the authenticity of Christianity. To explore more, go to AveMariaRadio.net. Under resources, look for me, Dr. Stan Williams.
This program is brought to you in part by Charity Mobile, a proud partner of Ave Maria Radio for over 15 years. Charity Mobile is the pro-life cell phone company and has sent nearly $2 million to thousands of pro-life charities. 4G LTE coverage is available nationwide, and 5% of your monthly plan price goes to your favorite pro-life charity. A video introduction is available at CharityMobile.com. Charity Mobile. Everyday living, effortless giving. CharityMobile.com.
And good afternoon, I'm Al Kresta. Let's say again, the book is called Mary Among the Evangelists. It's Father, Dr. Christian Kappes, and William Albrecht. It's called The Definitive Guide for Solving Biblical Questions About Mary, and I noticed in the book, it's also listed as Biblical Dogmatics, Volume 1, so I should ask them what the series is going to look like when they're done with it. But it's about 150 pages, and it takes up all those vexing questions that are sometimes brought up by non-Catholic Christians regarding Catholic dogmatics, regarding the Blessed Mother. I was shy. I tell you, that was one of my biggest problems in returning to the Catholic Church. It was how you could ground the dogmas regarding Mary in the actual text of Scripture. And it was a long time, but it finally hit me. And this book, I wish I had had it back then.
Kresta in the Afternoon is a co-production of Ave Maria Radio and EWTN Radio, and carried across the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network. To follow up on any of the guests or information presented on today's program, visit the Kresta Guest Archive at AveMariaRadio.net. That's A-V-E-M-A-R-I-A, radio.net. To listen to this or any other edition of Kresta in the Afternoon, visit the audio archives at AveMariaRadio.net. Or to order a CD of the program, call 734-930-4506 or email orders at AveMariaRadio.net. That's 734-930-4506 or orders at AveMariaRadio.net.